greetings from the border. Welcome everybody to this meeting of Canals. First of all, I'm going to be on Council colleagues and leader of the Council. Obviously, the main item tonight will be the budget proposals, but there's a few preliminary things I'd like to do, so please bear with me. I think it would be remiss of us if we didn't recognise the passing of Nelson Mandela. Okay, the other item I just want to mention at the start is, again, it would be remiss, I think, of those of the Cabinet if we didn't record our sincere thanks to all members of staff of the Council who did a fantastic job to help people cope with the storms last week. I know in many parts of the world, our teams were out working around the clock, and I just, on behalf of the Cabinet, want to say a big thank you to all our staff who worked with emergency services and residents to make sure that people were kept safe. So a big thank you. If we could record that, please, in the midst of this meeting, I'd be really grateful. Thank you very much. Okay, item one, just need to do this very quickly. A member's code of conduct. Does any member of the Cabinet wish to declare any interests in the agenda, the item on the agenda? Okay, so we'll vote that. Item two, the minutes of the previous meeting. Can we agree that I will sign those minutes? Okay. Okay, thank you for that. Which passes on to the finance items. The first item that we'll take is item three, which is the Council Budget Elections 2014-17. I really just want to highlight the fact that we've got a pretty big challenge ahead of us, because if we look at the table in page three, we will see that, as we know, we need to achieve savings next year, 27.5 million. We then got further 30.7 million in 15-16, and a further 25.1 million in 16-17. So we've got some big kind of challenges around not just next year, but the following 2 years. And clearly, tonight is about trying to put things in place to deal with that. So I think at this stage, I'm going to suggest that we just agree the recommendation, which is to note the forecast funding gap for 2014-17 and the assumptions that are included in those projections, and a further update being presented to Budget Cabinet in February. Is that agreed? Okay, that takes us on now to item four, which is the budget consultation feedback. analysis of the key findings. And I'm going to ask Graham, the Budget UK Secretary, just to introduce this report, and then I'll say this after that. So, Graham, over to you.
Yes, Chair. First of all, I'm going to say that, once again, this is an extremely extensive report, probably more extensive than virtually any other authority in the country. I think it's a good source of pride, I think, that this council extends this consultation for making these decisions. And you see, in paragraph 2-3, there are over 6,500 questionnaires received back, which is a fantastic response. That was actually extended on our previous database by the Trendar database. So almost 50,000 questionnaires were sent out to people across the Wirral. In addition to that, there were 200 events organised, sort of individual groups, and the information and questionnaires were distributed through almost 800 retail locations. So a really strong attempt to get a view of the diversity of the world and our staff. I mean, I would say out of 6,500, just over 1,800 of the responses were from the Royal Council staff, so very pleased to receive those. In terms of paragraph 6 and page 3 of the report, you see that we also attempt to ensure that future may be able to present the target a good response from them. So in 6.2 and 6.3, you see descriptions of how we try to engage human people in this process. In 6.4, referring to the old department and its involvement in the process. And in the lesbian, gay, bisexual community will be attentive and trust and other organisations. And also, we have city meetings with user groups, art groups, sports clubs, and children's centres in particular. And also, in paragraph 7, you see a reference to the consultation of the voluntary community and faith sector. In addition to that, we also received a whole number of petitions that outlined in part 8 of the consultation. Our members themselves were engaged in this in great detail by the Council Policy and Performance Committees to analyse question officers around those areas. In relation to the analysis of the results, paragraph 10.7 makes reference to the fact that there's a good demographic split. And in appendix 4, I'm not going to go into detail, but in appendix 4 gives real detail on the age split across the world, and also the information regarding the between age ranges of the age people who have responded to them. I also would like to go on to the appendices, extraction feedback. I don't tend to go through the detailed agreement for themselves. I'd only say that 10 of the options that were actually opposed by more than half of the respondees approached on. They were all in the regen and environment section of the report, which commences on page 15. And there were three areas where there were specific concerns. Number 9 in relation to the parks option and the proposals, this is that set out there, there was majority against. Option number 12, which is the highways and the maintenance option. And option 14, regarding the car park charges. 33, where there was majority opposition to those. Proposals. I think the rest of the information showed a varying degree of support and opposition, and I think members will be able to take those into account when we make the decision. So, as I would say, thank you for the staff who worked extremely hard in actually providing this information, and thank you for the public for responding so well to the questionnaires and the engagement meetings.
Okay, thanks, Graham. I just want to to all our staff who organised and coordinated the consultation process, because I know they worked extremely hard to make sure we got the best possible answer from members of the public. So a big thank you to the team officers who were leading that piece of work. Okay, I think clearly we need to agree recommendations, we need to vote the act in the consultation process. In a moment, I'm going to move a resolution around the budget options. But before I do that, you know, we've had in the last few weeks a number of detailed meetings with our trade union reps. I know that both you may need United Ministers would like to address the cabinet before I move my recommendations. So I'm going to first of all ask Alan and Little from Unite, if you want to come. Sorry. I'm small, sorry. Do apologise. Just yes. Alan Small from Unite to address the cabinet, and then I'm going to ask Phil Goodwin from Unison to say to Alan, over to you.
Come on, Alan.
Most of the feedback I had from our members was that it was as though
to bear with me, I'm just going to highlight some of the salient points, but the actual detailed resolution has been given out for you to read in detail. So, can I just start off by saying, clearly last year we made some extremely difficult decisions in order to set a legal budget. This year, due to continuing large, disproportionate, I would argue, unfair cuts by the government in our budget, we are in the same position once again. I've said many times in this council that authorities like Wirral have been put in an almost impossible position by this government. Given that we rely on funding from the government to generate the vast majority of our income, then clearly if the government makes huge cuts, as it has done, then we will have to cut our cloth accordingly. My objection is not so much to the scale of cuts, although they are very, very draconian. I think for me it's about a lack of fairness in the way that the cuts have been distributed. You know, it cannot be fair, according to figures from the SIGOMA, the Special Interest Group of Metropolitan Authorities, government funded rural councils were cut by £632 per head, whereas the average council in the South East has only lost £3.5 per head. It cannot be fair that Wirral has lost £152 per person compared to just £2 per person in wealthy North Dorset. The fact that this is being done at the same time as we know our residents are having to cope with inflation busting increases in energy prices and huge cuts in benefits, I believe has contributed to real cost of living crisis. And as I said earlier on in the previous item, it's outrageous that once we put the budget to bed for 2014-15, we face further cuts of some £55 million between 2015 and 2017. And I am, you know, and I make this pledge, I'm determined to continue to do everything I can as leader of the council to lobby governments, ministers, to change course on these unfair cuts to councils like Wirral. So, in spite of this unhelpful context,